Hi, so we're getting near the 4th of July, and as I promised in the last video, I'm going to do a video here on making colored smoke bombs. And what I'm going to do is start out with some examples, and then we'll get into the lab and I'll show you how I did it. That one obviously is yellow.
Yeah.
What if you mix it? Alright, so now we're going to go to the lab and I'm going to show you how we did that. See you in a bit. So, how did we do that? The promise last time was to show you how to make colored smoke bombs, and that's what we're going to do tonight. If you've looked on Google, you can find some recipes, various ways of trying to put these together. And if you look on YouTube, you'll see some demonstrations of people who have. Some of the results are okay, some maybe not so satisfactory, and some are actually a little misleading or even deceptive. And to better understand that, just like last time, we'll start out with the chemistry. The white smoke bombs, which depend on the vaporization of the paraffin wax, generate an opaque fog even if the wax is heated to a very high temperature. Even if it decomposes somewhat, it doesn't matter, because it'll still produce the fog. But when you're trying to produce a colored smoke, you need the dye molecules that are being atomized to remain intact. You can't have them decompose, and they are thermally sensitive. So if the mixture that you're burning runs too hot, you'll decompose the dye and you won't see the color. You'll get byproducts that aren't colorful. So the first thing you need to do is you need to modify the oxidizer. The potassium nitrate that we used in the last video requires a relatively high temperature to release its oxygen and support the flame. And so to lower the temperature further and still support the reaction, you need to change to potassium chlorate. Still an oxidizer, but it will release the oxygen at a lower temperature. If you were to burn the sugar with the potassium chlorate without anything else in there, it would still burn way hotter than the dyes will tolerate. And so you need to cool the reaction off to just above the limit where the potassium chlorate will release its oxygen. And in the last video, what we did is we cooled it off using wax. And you'll notice in some of the YouTube videos that you'll see about this, people obtain their colored dyes by melting candles or crayons. The problem with using wax, though, is that the wax will still be atomized. You'll still get a white fog. And even if you color it, you'll get sort of washed out pastel colors. You won't get the brilliant saturated colors that you saw in the video. So you need another method of cooling it off. And a very good method is to use carbonates. There are a bunch of them. The magnesium carbonate is one, sodium bicarbonate is another. The carbonates cool off the reaction because the carbon dioxide that's released when they decompose, it has a very high specific heat and carries away a lot of energy. But also the decomposition process itself is endothermic. It sucks up energy in order to decompose the molecules. Magnesium carbonate is a good choice because it decomposes at a lower temperature than, say, sodium bicarbonate. It's a good carbonate for cooling. And so the formula that I use includes both the potassium chlorate as the oxidizer and magnesium carbonate as the cooling agent. The
addition of a little bit of sodium bicarb is added just to sort of tweak the burn. It's only a couple of percent, but it does seem to help the reaction to proceed stably without being too hot or too cold. The final part of the ingredient is the sugar. A lot of formulas will recommend using lactose. Couldn't quite understand that. It's a dye sugar just like table sugar or sucrose. And so I experimented with that, and I found that the lactose and the sucrose both produce just about the same quality of smoke. The lactose may be just very slightly better, but it's almost in the noise. And because lactose is harder to get and it's substantially more expensive, you can substitute sucrose for the reactions and you'll be just fine. One of the things, though, that I showed in the other video is that when you prepare the compounds, you want to make sure that you grind up the more granular or the larger particles. The potassium chlorate, which is similar to potassium nitrate in that it's hygroscopic, it absorbs water, over a period of time will absorb water and become chunky and large chunks and particles. And that's not going to mix well. So when you grind this up in the food processor or a little coffee grinder, you want to get this to a nice fine mixture and you want to blend it pretty quickly so that it doesn't absorb any additional water. Same thing with the sucrose. It's also pretty granular and you want to grind it up and then mix in the magnesium carbonate and the sodium bicarbonate to form the final burn mixture. One neat technique I found is that you can add the colors later. And so I make up a sort of a raw generic burn compound and I put it in a container. These paint containers that you can get from, say, the big box stores are a kind of nice choice because they're cheap. They provide an airtight seal and that prevents the water from being absorbed by the material and becoming blocky again. But it's also a nice way to mix it. Rather than stirring it with a great big stick, you can just put all the compounds in there, pound this closed, and then just shake it up. And the shaking process gets a nice blend without producing a lot of dust that would get into the air and it's kind of annoying to deal with. The other thing that's important when you're mixing up the compounds is that all of the colored dyes that I've experimented with all work at the same percentage. So when you make up the raw mix, you can then just add the colors of your choice at the time that you make them. And it's kind of nice to do the separate operations because that way you don't have to be grinding, mixing all the time. The percentages that I use, the formula, I'll post it in the comments section below. But I use a 27% of the potassium chlorate. I use 18% of the sugar, sucrose or lactose, it doesn't matter. 16% of the magnesium carbonate. And 3% of the sodium bicarbonate to make up the raw burn mix. Once that's mixed up, then I measure that out into a container, and then I make up the difference, the 36%, with the colored dye. Another trick when you're doing this, and you're making the powder, is that you want to let it settle after you mix it for a while, because when you first open it, you'll see there's a little bit of dust that comes out of here just from that little bit of shaking I did a minute or two ago. And so if you don't let it settle, it'll end up kind of undoing the whole advantage of doing it in a container like this when you mix it. But the trick is to make sure that when you blend in your dyes, use a very large container, even though you're not going to fill it up completely, because it's much easier to stir a very low level of powder in here without getting a lot onto the floor. So what we're going to do is I'm going to make up a 100 gram mix with 64 grams of the burn and 36 grams of the colored dye. So very light and fluffy. The magnesium carbonate is very bulky, and so you'll find that even though you're only adding 16% of that, you'll double the volume of the compound with just that one component because of its extremely large volume and low weight. So once we get to 64 grams, or pretty close, then what we're going to do is we're going to add the dye. And one thing to be very careful about is that the dyes are very special. It turns out that in order for this mixture to work, you need to use a dye that is as thermally stable as possible. One of the early experiments I did was to use food-grade dyes, these water-soluble dyes, make a very brilliant compound when you mix them up. They're very rich and saturated in color. But when you burn them, color completely disappears. They won't survive the temperature. So what you need to use is what's called a solvent dye. And a solvent dye is a dye that is soluble in nonpolar solvents like acetone or alcohol. And it is horribly staining. You got to be very careful. That's why the drop cloth, you want to use old clothes. Make sure there's no fans on in the room when you're doing this. And blend it carefully because wherever it goes, it's going to stay. You can get these online, you can get it on eBay, you can get it from a couple of companies in the UK and in the United States. And I'm going to add a total of 36 grams of this to the 64 grams that I already added. Try not to get too much all over the place. Try not to get any on the camera also. Some of the dyes are a little more concentrated. In other words, they add their weight at smaller volumes. But in general, they all have roughly the same volume. So you can expect that when you get the final mix, it will take up about the same amount of room in your tube. And once you kind of know what you're going to end up producing, then you can fine-tune the total volumes that you're making. Or make a large quantity and just fill as many containers as you have access to when you do it. So I think we got about 100 here. That's awfully close. Let's call it quits. Now what I'm going to do is blend this up, and you don't have to do a very good job because the dye is just a passenger in the formula. It doesn't do very much, and so even if it wasn't blended very effectively, you just probably get variations in the saturation of the color, but it won't affect the burn. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to finish blending up this. And then what I'm going to get into is how to build the containers that you put this in, because they don't have to be as robust as the mortar shell-like containers I made with the cement for the other smoke bombs. The lower temperatures and the lower pressures make that possible. So now that this is pretty well blended up here, what we're going to do is set this aside for a second. This is 100 grams of material. I'm using the same size containers as I did before, which are 2 inches in diameter, 4.5 inches long. I'm not going to need to use this very robust shell, and that makes it a lot easier to make these up, and you don't have to wait for them to dry either. So the technique I use is to take a sealant material. This is an RTV high temperature gasket material. You can get this at auto supply houses. It has a decomposition temperature over 650 degrees Fahrenheit. It's not as good an adhesive as some of the RTVs are. It's not bad. But it provides a good seal and doesn't burn. And you can even use the smoke bomb before this is fully dried, which is kind of nice. So the technique is, I put a small layer of this around the edges of the tubes. Do another one. And this doesn't have to be neat. You just want something to go around there that's going to form sort of like a rubber gasket and help to seal the smoke inside. Now this material cures with humidity, and so the way to get this to cure faster is I take these discs, I get these from a pyrotechnics supply house, and I spritz it with a little bit of water, not a lot, but the moisture here will help the RTV to cure rather quickly. Put that on there like that, do another one, put it on there like that, and then to retain it, I don't need to do something quite as robust as last time. And the technique I use is I take some of this heavy gauge aluminum taping made for air handling systems. I put it around the edge so that some of it stands off over the edge, like this. Wrap it around here kind of firmly. And once I've made this extended layer up here, I then bend in the sides. And because this material is pretty stiff, when you bend all these sides in, and it's pretty hard to do, I have to use a lot of finger pressure to do this, you end up with a nice retaining layer that helps to hold the material on even if the adhesive isn't the best. So when you got a couple of these things done, then what you're going to end up doing is filling up the containers with the dye compound. And you can do this pretty quickly. I was sort of showing you how before, but I mean, you can pop these off really fast if you're in a hurry. And the nice thing is you don't have to wait for the stuff to dry. You can burn this right away. So if you're impatient, it'll still work. Now, once these are done, want to fill them. And as I said, this stuff gets everywhere, so you want to be very careful that you blend or you hold, handle this pretty carefully. Disposable spoons are pretty nice. And as you notice, this is very fluffy material. It goes into the container, and 100 grams is about enough to fill one of these containers, just a little more than you need. And this particular dye, even though it seems purplish in the room light, it burns a very brilliant orange. It's very nice. Now, I'm not going to fill this all the way up because I'm going to show you another technique. If you don't want to make a very large bomb and you still want this not to move around a lot inside, a little technique you can use is to make up the gap in the space that you have there with some cotton. Just an organic cellulose will work just fine. So take a little piece of wick, cut it off, stick it in here like this. I add a little bit of that rich 50-50 potassium nitrate and sugar compound as a little bit of a starter. Helps to get this going. And then take the cotton and fill up the gap around here so that nothing moves around when you're transporting this or you're handling it, and you don't get the stuff kind of pouring out of the top. Once the cotton's in there like that, and another little bead of this stuff around the edge, take one of these discs that has a hole in it already, spritz over the wick, down like that, tear off some tape, and you got a smoke bomb. And it's nice, too, if you're going to do these, to do a bunch of them at the same time, because you can tear off the tape ahead of time, and you have everything lined up, and you don't have to then worry about the mess. You get all the mess done at one time in one place, and then you clean it up, and you don't have the chance of getting things spread around. So this is how I made one of the smoke bombs that I showed you before in the video, and obviously you can make a lot of these. It's probably about 90 grams in here. The material also has another property, and that's what I'm going to talk about in the next video. You can modify this. You can bring this up a notch, and the way that you do that is you're going to modify the formula a little bit so that you can add some additional compounds that make the handling a little easier and make a smoke bomb that you can't buy. So I'll see you in a little bit. As I promised, in this experimenting, I discovered that the annoying thing about the powder was that it tends to get everywhere, and it is a little bit difficult to pack. And so I made a discovery, and that is because of the low temperatures that these colored smoke mixes burn at, it's possible to add other things to them that enhance the packing and the handling, but also make these smoke bombs a lot more interesting when they burn. And what you can do is you can modify the raw burn material by a little bit. You change the potassium chlorate from 27% to 29% at the expense of the magnesium carbonate from 16% down to 14%. And when you have that slightly hotter burning, richer material, what you can do is you can add an oil to the final compound after you mix in the dyes. And the oil makes it possible for you to handle it a lot better, and I'll show you what that entails. But the really interesting thing, the thing that really makes this fascinating, is you can use any oil you want to. You don't just have to use, say, olive oil or corn oil. You can use scented oils. You can use any of the oils that are normally sold for aromatherapy, candle making, essential oils, potpourries. These oils are extremely potent, and when they get heated, they atomize and they spread out over an area far larger than the smoke plume that comes out of the smoke bomb. And you can even design them so that, for example, if you're making a green smoke, you can make it smell like pine, or you can make it smell like eucalyptus, red, roses. You can choose whatever kind of smell you want. So I'm going to show you how I do that. I use a different compound here, and the material looks the same, but like I said, it's a little bit richer to support the additional burden of the oil. And I'm going to mix it up the same way we did before. I'm going to start with a container here. And we're going to start with the same basic percentage, which is I'm going to use 64 grams of the powder. And you'll watch me do this just like you saw in the last one. So this is sort of deja vu all over again. We'll get this up to 64. And then once we do that, I'm going to add the dye to get the color. You want to add all the dry components together at the same time. Now, in this case, what we'll use is yellow dye. So I have some of this solvent dye, yellow color. And we're going to add 36 grams of this yellow dye to this. Once you have the dye mixture and the powder, you're going to want to blend that up just like you did before for the other smoke bomb. And the large container keeps you from getting it all over yourself and all over the room. Do a little bit of mixing here first. And then once you're done, what you want to do is you want to add to that mixture 20% of that weight in addition in the form of an oil. And you'll see this very fluffy compound here. It's very lightweight, very easily sort of dispersed. And it's also a little harder to work with when you're trying to fill the smoke bombs. But then what you do is you add the oil. Now in this case, with the yellow, I have to make up my mind. Cinnamon, orange, clove, gardenia. I love gardenia. So I know the color isn't necessarily right, but I'm going to add this anyway. So what we want to do is we want to bring this to 120 grams. So I'm going to add that till we get there. You can be 20 to 25% is just fine. It's not going to make that much of a difference. Stuff isn't cheap. I found that Bulk Apothecary is one of the better online sources for relatively inexpensive and extremely reliable, potent material. The other interesting source is Walmart. The higher priced stuff at Walmart turns out to be really pretty competitive, and you can also smell it there rather than having to hope that you remember the smell of some bizarre spice. I've also tried dry spices like ginger, allspice, cinnamon. None of them work. They all smell like wood when they burn. You don't get the same sort of richness that you do with the oil form. Now, at first, it looks like I didn't even add anything. It gets lost. But as you start to bring it up, you'll start to get these lumps. And as you continue to mix it, the lumps start to spread out, and the stuff starts to get more like a clay. Just bring it around like this. Man, does that smell good. My son commented, he said it smells like the bathroom in a very expensive hotel. Now you want to spend a little bit of time stirring this, not just because the smell is so pleasant, but because you want the oil to disperse pretty evenly. You don't want certain parts to be overloaded with oil and not burn evenly. And so this part can actually take you a couple of minutes. I'm not sure if we'll edit all of this out, but we may edit some of it just because it gets a little bit time consuming. Big container, big stick, lets you get this stuff around. And you'll find that even small amounts on the bottom can represent a fair amount of the oil. So you want to really make sure you're moving it around to get the stuff off and kind of incorporate it. As you continue to do this, the mixture will continue to get more and more homogeneous and less lumpy. Now, I'm not going to hold you for the whole time, because what I'm going to do is I'll finish mixing this up. And then what I'm going to do is another modification that this makes possible to your smoke bombs. So we'll come back in a little bit after I've made up a couple of these identical blends, but two different colors and two different scents. All right, this is just about done. I got a comment here in the background saying, you know, why not lemon? It's yellow. Well, I like gardenia a lot. I use it even when it's inappropriate. All right, so now here's the neat trick. One of the containers that we made. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put this material in here. And it's a lot easier to handle now because it is sort of cakey. It doesn't blow around a lot. That's one of the nice things about this. And man, does it smell good. Now, I'm not going to fill the container all the way up. I'll show you why, because there's a neat trick that you can use in addition to the fact that you get this wonderful smell out of this material. And that is because it tends to pack well. What you can do is you can mix them. So what I do is, see that's in there like that. I'm just going to tap a little bit, kind of even it out a little bit. Then what I do is I take a little piece of plastic, put it on top here, take a little disc that's a little smaller than that, push it down here a little bit, not real far, just to kind of even it out like that. Then I made up some more eucalyptus and pine. So we're going to fill the top of this now with a different color and a different scent. And because this packs well, the flame front tends to move downward through it rather than sort of moving outward from the central hole. And so as a result, you get one color burning and one kind of scent. And then as soon as it gets down to the next layer, you get another color and another scent. It's really cool. Now, maybe just a tiny bit more. And then because it packs, I'm going to do something like I did before. Take my little disc, my plunger disc, put it in here just to push it down a little bit so it's not all over the sides. Then make a little hole here, but I'm not going to go very deep because I don't want the wick to go very far. And then I'm going to take a piece of wick, put it in here like this. Again, I don't want to penetrate all the way to the other one because I don't want it to start. And then put a little of my starter compound up here to get things going. Put a little bit of my cotton here. This is probably redundant because this stuff doesn't move around very much. But the cotton helps keep things more stable. Then a little bit of gasket. Just like before. A little water spritz on my disc. And a little piece of my aluminum tape. And as soon as we're done in here, I'm going to go out and we're going to burn some of these. And you get to see what it looks like. It's a shame you can't see what it smells like. All right. See you in a little bit.
So these are the two color smoke bombs that change color while they're burning. We built them in the lab just a couple minutes ago and trying to get out of them. They also smell wonderful. This is rose, this is eucalyptus, and as soon as it gets down to the bottom level, you'll see that the colors start to change a little bit and the smells will change too. Plus you can smell them even when you're not in the smoke. The oil seems to disperse a lot farther. Now we're to yellow. Lemon. Okay, so this is the double mix we made with the lemon yellow, and then it's followed by the violet that we used earlier on.
It does really smell like lemon.
Doesn't it? Yeah, it's really neat. It's still yellow. Still smells good. And because these lower temperature smoke bombs don't get very hot, you can hold these things for a long time. At the end of the burn, it might be a little bit uncomfortable. It's not bad. Can you guys smell the yellow here, there?
Yeah, definitely.
Smells a little different now. I'm wondering if it's starting to change a little. You're right in it. The oil gives it a lot more longevity too. There we go. So not bad, huh? So you've got to try this. These double smoke bombs with the double colors and the double scents, you can't buy these. You can only make them yourself. And they're not difficult, and they last a long time, and the colors are very rich, and you can customize them to make them whatever color you like. So I want to thank you very much for watching. And happy 4th of July.